Welcome back to the WFTDA Division II playoffs in beautiful Kalamazoo, Michigan. My name is Lightning Slim. I am joined by my very good friend, AK 40 Ounce. And we are about to announce the game between the 8th seed Tri-City Roller Girls and the number 4 seed Carolina Roller Girls.
That's right. Looking at what brought us to this point, the Carolina Roller Girls, number 4, edged out Suburbia earlier today by 1 point at 10 a.m., so they're in action for the second time today. They lost yesterday, of course, to Neo, 222-178. Now, that win this morning was the first sanctioned win for the Carolina Roller Girls this season. They are 1-8 in 2013. Tri-Cities, on the other hand, of course, beat Burning River 190-174 and then lost by 5 points to Santa Cruz in overtime. That brings their overall season record to 3-5. As you said, Tri-Cities number 8, Carolina number 4. Now, the winner of this one will go on to play tomorrow at 2 for 5th place, and the loser will play tomorrow at noon for 7th. So no matter what, Tri-Cities, northward movement in the rankings, at least in this tournament, and Carolina holding on, hoping to drop only to 5th place and play the winner of the Burning River Paper Valley game, which is coming up after this one.
Sounds to me, AK, like what you're saying means we got two teams coming in hot for two very different reasons.
Absolutely. Of course, Carolina was very fired up coming into this, very determined to make some progress. And Tri-Cities, of course, a little bit of a heartbreaker yesterday, but they're hanging on. And, of course, they've already moved up regardless of what happens in these next couple bouts.
And we're about ready to begin on the jammer line for their respective teams. You see in the white, Tri-City, it is number 11, Overkill, jamming for them. In the black and red, Carolina, their most productive jammer, number 75, She's a Freak, takes the line for her team.
Yeah, She's a Freak has been phenomenal for Carolina. She really sparked the game yesterday, and when they came back and almost beat Neo, and she was a very, very productive part of the Suburbia defeat earlier today. Of course, Overkill, one of the top two producing jammers for Tri-Cities in this tournament.
And the action underway. She's a Freak makes an early play to the front of the pack. Overkill maintained at the rear. She is blocked there by Caddy Compton, and we have a lead jammer. That is She's a Freak. She's a Freak approaching the rear of the pack on a scoring pass. Just sails right on through, avoiding the Hellcat of Pinar. That is a grand slam. Early penalty on the play. Number 40, Lizzie Borden for Tri-City, takes a seat.
Yep, she's going to the notorious RED penalty box for an out of play. So first jam, first penalty.
Overkill in the free and open spaces, but She's a Freak has already done the damage. Calls off the jam, and that will put Carolina ahead by 9 after the first jam.
Got to mention, you know, we're talking about the brackets and how this is all playing out. Make sure you check out Cheeseball Bearings Bracket Bonanza. Of course, can't get in on the action for this one. If you already have, be interested to hear how you're doing it. Talk to WFTDA. That's hashtag talk, the number 2, WFTDA. And you can find more about Cheeseball Bearings at cheeseballs.com.
Neutralizer takes the line for Caroline. She faces number 22, Freudian Whip.
Neutralizer, not a lot of jamming yesterday, a little bit more today. Freudian Whip, the other of the 1-2 punch from Tri-Cities.
Bit of a push and shove. Freudian Whip tries to shopping cart the defenders in front of her, trying to get out of the pack fairly. She does so. Lead jam for Tri-City. Fox Smolder colliding there with one of the defenders of Carolina. Meanwhile, Neutralizer inside the pack being held up, looks for support from her blockers, held at the inside line. And Neutralizer still inside the pack as Freudian Whip gets into the pack on a scoring pass and is knocked down, holding her face as she lies on the track.
Looks like a high block that took her down.
Tri-City coach Jay Robot running over to attend to his skater.
Now, always hate to see this, and obviously we hope she comes back for this game. Not only would that be disappointing, I hate to see injuries of any kind, but a tough break for Tri-Cities. As we said, that's it's mainly been a 1-2 punch of Freudian Whip and Overkill. Freudian Whip, really the workhorse of that duo. The high block coming from Fox Smolder, and Freudian Whip is up. She gets checked out by our crack EMT staff, and hopefully we'll see her in about 4 jams.
Reloading the weapons of track destruction, we have Overkill and She's a Freak. A repeat of an earlier jam.
Of course, if you're curious why I said 4 jams, The little clarification here. Fox Mulder picked up the high block. She plays for Tri-Cities. So not sure. Didn't see it from our angle. I apologize for that. Regardless, Tri-City now with two in the box. So it'll be 4-2 pack advantage for Carolina as we start this third jam.
I think we're just waiting for Jay Robot, the coach for Tri-City, to head back to his bench. He has returned there. I see over by the EMTs that Freudian Whip getting a little ice for the face, but otherwise seems to be operating under her own power.
And she did pick up 3 points before she went down, so Tri-City on the scoreboard, 9-3 in favor of Carolina after two jams.
Whistles are applied to mouths. She's a freak. Overkill, here they go. She's a freak, makes an early play to the inside line, and Overkill tries the center route. Both of them are immediately mugged by the defenders of the opposing team. Overkill forces her way through to the inside line. Lead jam, Tri-City.
Carolina picking up their first trip to the Notorious RD penalty box. Multiplayer block on MC Fight is going to leave Carolina down a blocker.
MC Fight, the captain of Carolina. Overkill on a scoring pass, heads towards the pack. It is quickly moving. She's calling for support from her blockers to create a bit of room for her on the track. Jam coming to a close. A 2-point pickup for Tri-City, and that will bring the score 9-5. Working every day.
And working every day to help you out when your roller derby adventure. It's experienced derby skaters getting the right gear for you to take you to the next level. Derby for All. You can check them out online at derby4all.com.
Taken to the jammer line for her first turn this contest. Number 26 for Carolina. It's Keddie Klismic. And she faces number 69, Praying Mantis. New jammers, fresh blood. We will see what happens.
Yeah, both these jammers with some turns with the star the last couple games. Not a lot. Praying Mantis had a beautiful hit in the pack earlier. So we'll see what she can do with the star right there.
Katie Klismic taken out there by Mandy Maggotbone. And that allows Praying Mantis out into that lead jammer position. Number 66 for Carolina. Daisy Rage heads to the box. And Praying Mantis on a scoring pass. A depopulated track as Carolina gets into penalty trouble. Praying Mantis sails on through, and that is a 4-point pass.
Yeah, penalties coming in groups right there at the end. So two in the box will be a 4-2 pack advantage for Tri-City. They've tied it up 9-9 here with 3:40 ticked off in the first half.
We have fresh jammers once again, AK Skate Pastor, number 10 in the white for Tri-City, in the black and red for Carolina, number 187. Caddy Compton, normally very strong in the pack for Carolina. She's taken a turn with the star.
Yeah, she has been effective. They used her a bit in the second half yesterday, and she was very much a blammer. She can power through some of those packs right there, having some trouble though.
Skate Pastor, shopping carting at the front of the pack, breaks through. She is lead jammer number 10, Skate Pastor, former figure skater, now puts on the jets and tries to get some speed into it as she is on a scoring pass.
That's going to be three leads in a row of four, Tri-City. After Carolina jumping off to that 9-0 start, Tri-City coming back and tying it up.
Skate Pastor approaching the pack, scoots through the center with a diagonal movement and just makes it very quickly through the pack and calling off the jam. Skate Pastor puts up four and the door. And we have a lead change, AK.
Indeed we do. Tri-City has taken the lead 13-9. If you're playing along at home, make sure you take a sip of your Liftoff by Derbalife, the official drink of the WFTDA announcers. It's an all-natural energy drink for announcers and skaters alike.
It's what gives us our pep, ladies and gentlemen. Ginger Clobbers taking her first turn on the jammer line for Carolina. She faces Freudian Whip. Ginger Clobbers making an early play to the inside line, but she is rebuffed by Ann X. We have yet to see a lead jammer declared. Both of them roiling within the pack, and a penalty to Freudian Whip means this is a power jam for Carolina.
Yeah, good break here for Carolina. They started strong, but now looking to answer back as Tri-Cities has blanked them the last three jams in a row.
Fox Smolder and Praying Mantis, acting in a blocking capacity, are bedeviling Ginger Clobbers. They have knocked her to the track more than once. Ginger Clobbers, made of rubber, bounces back up. She wants to get those points for Carolina. Now Ann X knocking Ginger Clobbers off the track, forcing her to re-engage with the pack. She is your lead jammer and finally escapes from the bruising she's been getting from Tri-City.
Yeah, she picked up a no pass, no penalty in there, but did pass everybody cleanly. Tri-City now going to lose another one to the box. It's Fox Mulder, her second trip.
And X knocking down Ginger Clobbers once again. Rainbow's Bright getting in on the action, and we see a penalty that is to Rainbow's Bright. A little too much mustard on that hit, but a track cut. Very effective there. Rainbow's Bright probably thinking it was worth it as she heads to the notorious RED sin bin.
Yeah, and that sin bin is filling up right now. Another skater in the box, a full box of blockers for Tri-City. They've got one out there, but they are on a power jam.
You see the return from injury Freudian whip on your screen there, forcing her way through the pack. She is returned from the penalty box also, completes her first pass, and she will begin to score right now. A bit of push-pull defense against her, bodies fall to the track. Freudian whip skates on, and that is a grand slam.
Indeed, it is pushing it up, doubling up the score now, 18-9 in favor of Tri-Cities. Power jam continuing.
Coming around the mountain again, Freudian whip puts up another grand slam. Tri-City putting the hammer down as they try to take full advantage of the power jam situation. Freudian whip inside the pack scoots to the outside to avoid the defenders of Carolina, and five more points as the jam comes to a close.
Yeah, she had a lot of open country out there with only two blockers per team. And it was a great placement by Tri-Cities to get those Carolina defenders in front of them right in the middle of the track, and it gave Whip a lot of room on either side to pick from. Of course, she went to the outside.
With 22 and a half minutes remaining, Tri-City doubling up on Carolina. Their score 28 to Carolina's 14. Still flying solo on the jammer line. Just a bit of power jam remaining for number 11, Overkill, and it looks like we have a bit of a false start. The whistles blow, and we have a brief timeout.
Officials conferring. We'll get you an update if it's anything of note. Meanwhile, if you are just joining us here on WFTDA.TV, I'm AK40Ounce with Lightning Slim. We have got Tri-City from Kitchener, Ontario, in the white with the black and a little bit of gray here and there, and the Carolina Roller Girls out of Raleigh, North Carolina, in the black and red.
22-22 on the official clock on the first period of play.
CruiseSkateShop.com offering quality tested derby gear and guidance since 2007. Make sure you check them out online. If we have, you know, an occasional official timeout, you can click over on your browser and check out some of our great sponsors, including Cruise Skate Shop. Of course, if you are a tweeter, you can tweet at us at #talk2WFTDA. And we'll get some shout-outs if you got questions, anything we can do to help.
We are ready to begin again here at the track. Very sparsely populated. Two blockers aside, Overkill the only jammer.
Well, we're going to send it over to our sideline reporter, Double H, for an update.
All right, thanks, guys. So what we're learning is that Ginger Clobbers actually did not commit a track cut. The skater, the opposing blocker that she passed, had been sent out for a penalty. And as she was leaving for the box, that was when Ginger passed her. So indeed, they're pulling her out of the box now, back to the jammer line for Ginger Clobbers.
That would explain the presence of She's a Freak wearing the jammer star back out on the track for Carolina.
Yeah, a lot of penalties early in this bout. Already looking Tri-Cities with six trips to the box and four trips to the notorious RED penalty box for Carolina. Score stands 28-14, 22-22 left in the first half of play.
Looks like a few more seconds of bookkeeping happening there. Null pointer ref holding his microphone.
Getting an update right now. They're just explaining the cutting penalty right there.
Indeed, null pointer ref from Montreal Roller Derby explaining in flawless franglais what has just happened.
So we've got a 2-2 pack out there, full box of blockers for both teams. And we've got a couple jammers back behind the line now that there is no jammer in the box for Carolina. Who do we have, Lightning Slim?
Overkill, number 11 in the white, in the black for Carolina. She's a Freak, both jammers of the right now. Here they go. Overkill makes an early play to the front, held back by what was almost a multiplayer block. However, she escapes. She is lead Overkill for Tri-City. She's a Freak struck down by Leezy Borden at the front of the pack. Meanwhile, Overkill skates on. She's a Freak maintaining her position on her backside, and it looks like the play is blown dead.
She went down pretty hard, and she seems to be favoring her right leg. It's already the second injury call-off we've had in this bout. For all your printing needs, hit up printcographics.com. Lead the pack with new UV ink printing at printcographics.com.
All players on the track taking a knee while medical professionals attend to the skater on the track. She's a freak jamming for Carolina. And we are having the paramedics waved in.
Scrappy bout here, early slim. That was a rough hit from Lizzie Borden, came over across, and she kind of had this right hook movement. It didn't look like a forearm. She did not receive a penalty as far as we've seen, but it was just that motion of her pushing her shoulder and her arm down on She's a Freak that gave her that extra momentum into the floor.
Lizzie Borden, number 40 for Tri-City. She is a designated hitter for that team, and that is her business, and she's known for hard blocking.
Yeah, and it was successful, but unfortunately looks like She's a Freak went down at kind of a weird angle, so she's being checked out right now, still seated.
22 minutes remain in the first period of play. Tri-City with a score of 33, Carolina at 14.
And, you know, Slim, coming into this, we had a lot of changes on the rosters, some last-minute additions and subtractions. Both these teams did come in with 14, but there were some questions as to who was going to be playing. And She's a Freak now up. She has her skates off and is walking, but slowly kind of working out that right leg. So
applause by everyone in attendance, because we all like to see a Derby girl return to the bench under her own power. She looks like she's able to stand at least and receive further attention from the EMTs.
That's right. We already had Freudian Whip get injured right in that same spot. And she has returned to play, so we hope the same for She's a Freak. She is definitely an asset with the star for Carolina.
That is the ever dangerous turn number two you're referring to, AK. Speaking of Freudian Whip, she is back on the jammer line for Tri-City, which means these tough women can shake off just about anything, and she faces Caddy Compton for Carolina.
2-2 pack again, full box, still full for both these teams.
Freudian Whip scoots around the inside. She is lead jammer.
Carolina getting one of their blockers back. That's number 121, Electric Q Shung.
Electrocution takes a hit from Mandy Maggotbone. Penalty on the play. Lippy Wrongstockings heads to the sin bin. Meanwhile, Freudian Whip on a scoring pass, cuts through the pack, takes what she can get. Four and the door. Good enough for Bonnie Thunders, good enough for Freudian Whip.
And even coming out of that injury timeout, Tri-City with that little bit of momentum keeping going, pushing their score up now 37-14. 23 points the difference with 21-21 left in the first half.
Taking her first turn on the jammer line, Ava Gore for Carolina, number 42. She faces Overkill.
Now we've already seen a handful of different jammers from Carolina. She's a Freak neutralizer, Ginger, Caddy, and now another one. So a wide rotation. I think they're just trying to see what's going to stick.
Overkill gains lead jam, but then falls. Does so again. Having some trouble keeping it wheel side down is Overkill. Meanwhile, Ava Gore gets jammer support from her blockers, forces her way to the front of the pack, and now we have a race.
Great job by Carolina, even though, as you said, Ova got lead jammer, but they held her up long enough for Ava Gore to get right back behind her. They're going to strike and strike fast. Ooh, team-on-team collision right there between two Carolina skaters. Yields no points for Carolina Roller Girls, but 4 points for Tri-Cities.
Penalty on the play as Eva Liza was wearing the pivot stripe, but Tri-City already had another pivot out there, and she heads to the notorious RED penalty area. Ginger Clobbers back to the jammer line. She faces Freudian Whip. Pack advantage Carolina.
Took the words right out of my mouth. I was thinking the same thing. Carolina getting another blocker back, so we have 4-on-2.
And lead jam to Ginger Clobbers, putting on a burst of speed. She's coming around. As you see there on your screen, Freudian Whip has also escaped the pack, but it is Ginger Clobbers on her scoring pass. Her teammates maintaining speed control. They Conga off to one side, give her the full track. She scoots through the two defenders of Tri-City and calls it off immediately.
Yeah, that was a great read right there by the Carolina Pack. They slowed it down. They knew that Ginger had the advantage on the track and had enough time to get in there. So wisely, they pulled off to the side, let her, you know, to her own devices a little bit, and she pays off. It's a nice chance right there that they took, and they are rewarded for it.
Maintaining that tight jammer rotation, Tri-City puts up Overkill once again, and she faces number 26, Katie Klismic.
Katie Klismic, second time jamming for her.
A rugby-style start. Lots of shoulders getting into it. Overkill trips over number 66, Daisy Rage. Katie Klismic out in front for lead.
A little bit more success on this one. Did not get lead jammer, got outscored her first time out, but now has lead jammer for Carolina.
Multiple penalties to Carolina. Electrocution and Daisy Rage will both take a seat in the sin bin. Overkill skating in the free and open spaces, but Katie Klismic is on a scoring pass. Held back there, and she calls it off. And that is a four-point pickup for Carolina.
It was a great job by Katie Klismic right there to break up that two-wall, kind of take them one-on-one individually. And, of course, it's a lot easier to beat one blocker than it is two blockers next to each other.
Just about 18 minutes remaining in the first half of play. Tri-City 41 points, Carolina 22. Caddy Compton once again returns to the jammer line. She faces Praying Mantees in the white, number 69. Action beginning immediately with all skaters crowded along that jammer line. Caddy Compton forces her way to the front. She has lead. And a track-cutting penalty to Praying Mantees. Power jam for Carolina.
Good opportunity here for Carolina. They had that strong start right at the beginning. And since then, Tri-Cities has been in control.
A reversal of fortunes. Caddy Compton receiving a track-cutting penalty there. I believe it was Mandy Megabone with a well-timed hit as Caddy Compton cruised on through. We'll do a little do-si-do in the sin bin. One must enter, one must leave, and the power jam will change hands.
That's right. This reversal of fortune paying off right off the get, quickly out of the box and through the pack. But, you know, that was the thing. Carolina, you get a little bit of run going, and then a bad break happens. That happened to them yesterday.
Praying Mantees finishes her initial pass, goes around the outside on her first scoring pass. That's a grand slam.
Both teams getting a blocker back as the jammer exits the box.
Indeed, AK. And Caddy Compton, having not long to serve, is now back on the track. Both jammers back into it. However, both jammers receiving a penalty. This jam will go the full 2 minutes.
That's right, she picks up a five and draws the penalty right there. Carolina going to be down, number 66, Daisy Rage, her second trip to the box. And, Compton right there going right back in.
Hellcat of Panar joins her, but Caddy Compton off the track. She cannot score, but Praying Mantees can. Five more on the board. Praying Mantees heads into the pack once more, just about 20 seconds remaining in the jam. Praying Mantees trying it slow and patient this time. They are forced to let her go. It was a no-pack situation. Puts up 5 points as rain blows bright for Tri-City. Heads to the box also.
You mentioned Hellcat Panar. She was not playing yesterday. It was a noticeable hole in their rotation just coming over this past season from Guelph, Royal City.
Indeed, Hellcat not here yesterday. Here today, I do believe she was simply traveling to get here to beautiful Kalamazoo.
Carolina finishing up with a grand slam on that one. That's going to bring us to 66-27 in favor of Tri-City. Tri-City in the white and black, and the Carolina Roller Girls in the black and red.
Skate Pastor, number 10, takes the jammer line for Tri-City. This is a power start for the ladies in white.
They do have the disadvantage at the start, though. Three blockers right there for Carolina. We'll see how Tri-City plays this one. They're going to ease back.
Tri-City's blockers simply stand off to one side and leave Skate Pastor to her own devices, hoping to stretch out that pack and get her outside the zone of engagement. She doesn't need them to do that as she, with some fancy footwork, gains lead jam.
Three wall of Carolina scrambling back and forth. Great lateral movement, but that allows her to find a hole and push through.
Skate Pastor skating onwards. Caddy Compton returns to the track. She must complete an initial pass. Skate Pastor inside the pack in a scoring capacity. Inter-pack hitting increasing. Leezy Borden tries to get into it with Caddy Compton. Caddy Compton escapes the pack. Four more points for Skate Pastor. We have a penalty on the play to Leezy Borden. She will take a seat for Tri-City.
Not something you see often, an out-of-play assist. right there. Of course, when you're out of play, you cannot engage either jammer. You cannot help your own jammer or oppose the opposing jammer.
Freudian Whip and Ginger Clobbers returning to the jammer line for their respective teams with just under 14 and a half minutes remaining in the first period of play. Tri-City 75, Carolina 27.
Looking at the penalties, we've got 10 for Tri-City already in this game. One quarter of play essentially done. And for Carolina, about 9 penalties. So keeping it tight, Tri-City a little bit more penalty trouble right now.
Freudian Whip trying to get to the front of the pack. One to beat. She does so. Lee jam for Freudian Whip.
Carolina with a full pack up front.
Ginger Clobbers with nifty footwork. She escapes the pack also, but Freudian Whip is on a scoring pass. Defenders fall in front of her. She is trying to skate fair, pushing while not using her hands, and calls off the jam.
Multiplayer block in that one right at the end. Forward number 66 on Carolina, Daisy Rage. Already 3 trips to the notorious RED penalty box for her. And with only 16 and a half gone, she's got to be really careful as this one wears on. We've already seen a number of foul outs throughout the weekend. And of course, with the very stalwart, important, and heavy rotation blockers, they've got to be careful as they do not foul up before the end.
3 blockers apiece for each team. Katie Klismick and Overkill, jammers of the right now. Here they go. Overkill taken out by Caddy Compton at the back of the pack. Katie Klismick faces a 3-wall at the front. Oh, just mugs, runs into Hellcat of Pinar, but is held up long enough for Overkill to achieve lead jam.
It was a great job right there, even with the deficit. Now back up to even strength.
Bloody Mess Jess holds up Katie Klismick for just a few seconds just as Overkill encounters the pack. She is on a scoring pass, sails on through, takes a hit there from Aurora Thunder. 4 points on the board for Tri-City.
Strong offensive blocking from Bloody Mess Jess up front. Now, she didn't hold the block the entire time that the jammer was coming up, but she got her engaged long enough to where the defender could not get back into position before Over got through. 83-27 our score. Tri-City with the lead. 12:15 left in the first half of gameplay. Thank you for joining us on WFTDA.TV. I'm AK 40 Ounce with Lightning Slim.
Thank you, AK. Number 42, Ava Gore in the black for Carolina. She faces number 22 in the white, Freudian Whip for Tri-City. One goes inside, one goes outside. No lead jammer has yet emerged, although Freudian Whip at the front against Ginger Clobbers acting in a blocking capacity. Freudian Whip shopping carting. Ginger Clobbers pushing on her, just trying to get her out of the way while skating fairly. Does so, Freudian Whip, lead jammer, although Ava Gore hot on her heels now. Blockers close up a wall in front of Ava Gore, and Freudian Whip is away to the races.
Great job right there to draw her back in and let the pack re-engage her, hold her up, and add a couple seconds to her time in the pack.
Ava Gore has escaped, however, and puts on a burst of speed, chasing a fast-moving pack. Freudian Whip now re-engaging on a scoring pass and calls off the jam as she engages, playing very conservatively. They want to maintain their lead.
They will tack 3 more points onto that score, making 86-27. Now, Slim, you said a shopping cart block. For those who are not familiar with the vernacular, could you please explain that?
By shopping cart, I mean the jammer was pushing on the bodies of the blocker, or plural blockers, in front of them while maintaining no contact with the hands or arms, basically just pushing until they can find an opening and find their way through.
Thank you for that.
Caddy Compton, Overkill, jammers of the now. Caddy Compton making an early play to the front, and that works for her. She is lead jammer. Overkill in hot pursuit.
Yeah, Caddy Compton right here needs a bit of a redemption jam after going to the box back-to-back her last time out. She did come back and put some points up right there. Oh, beautiful job by Compton to force Ova out.
Overkill put 1 foot wrong and, realizing she'd done so, had to recycle herself to the rear. However, jumps back into the play and forces Caddy Compton to call off the jam. Nothing neither way on that one.
Yeah, both get swallowed up by the pack there, and Compton, getting forced out into turn 4, decides to call it off. I think a smart move right there, because as we've seen, when she gets down a little bit, she I think over-engages, and that's what gets her into penalty trouble.
Absolutely, AK. Freudian Whip returns to the track. She faces Ginger Clobbers, number 299 for Carolina.
This next jam going to be brought to us by SinCitySkates.com. We don't sell it if we wouldn't play in it. SinCitySkates.com.
Freudian Whip tries the front, finds her way, blocked by Electrocution, knocked down. Both jammers taking a beating inside the pack. Ginger Clobbers has received a penalty. Power Jam Tri-City. Ginger Clobbers skating to the notorious RED sin bin. However, Freudian Whip takes a spill, lands on her posterior, and crawls to the inside of the oval looking for her way back into the pack. She conservatively goes all the way back to the rear of the pack. Penalty on the play to number 22 for Carolina, True Destruction.
Yeah, True Destruction, returning skater. She was retired and has rejoined Carolina. And, you know, maybe it's a little bit of rust, you know, picking up some penalties. But, you know, she was a longtime player for CRG, and I'm sure they're happy to have her back.
Freudian Whip, looking like she had it a little rough in that jam, decided once she gained lead to quickly call it off and get fresh legs on the track in the personage of number 11, Overkill.
Adam Wheels, a proud partner and official wheel of the WFTDA. You can check him out online at adamwheels.com.
Overkill, with the power start, negotiates her way through the pack, held up. However, not forever. She is lead.
That was a wise choice right there by Tri-City to hang back. Carolina's got some tough defense, but Overkill and Freudian Whip have done a good job of finding those little bit of holes and pushing them open.
Overkill outlasts, comes up with a grand slam. You see the pack at a virtual standstill. Tri-City just creeping and leaving her own devices against that three wall of Carolina defenders. She's trying to keep it clean. She does so. Comes up with another grand slam. That is 5 points for Overkill.
And look at this, tricky, sneaky by Tri-City, ever so slowly creeping backwards, forcing Carolina to move in the opposite direction.
Overkill scooting from inside to outside, puts up another grand slam as her opposite number, Ginger Clobbers, returns to the track. We have both jammers in play now as Lizzie Borden heads to the penalty box. The pack picks up speed. Overkill forced to chase those points. She's not afraid to do so. Jumps in, calls it off as she knows Ginger Clobbers is back on the track. Picks up two more.
Yep, cherry picked that skater on the track right there. Got the one coming out of the box. Carolina now with an empty notorious RED penalty box. One in there for Tri-City. So it'll be a 4-3 advantage. And here we see Carolina taking that back wall. They've been in the front, and it hasn't really worked out for them on the starts. So maybe coming back and being tightened in behind Tri-City's defenders will give them a little bit of extra, you know, oomph, I guess.
7 minutes remain in the first period of play. Tri-City 103, Carolina 27. The action underway. The Praying Mantis jamming for Tri-City. Katie Klismic, number 26 for Carolina. She falls to the inside. Electrocution getting into a blocking war with Fox Smolder. Penalty, two penalties to Tri-City. Lippy Wrongstockings and Annex both take a seat. Pack advantage, Carolina, and also lead jammer going there to Katie Klismic.
Yeah, Annex picking a high block major.
Up at the front of the pack, Electrocution tries to hold back. Praying Mantis gets some help there from Aurora Thunder. Effective play by the defenders of Carolina as Katie Klismic gets into it on her scoring pass, comes around on the inside line of the oval. That is a grand slam.
Yeah, only one blocker out there for Tri-City.
Pack being reformed by the referees.
Katie Compton off to the box, so it'll be a 3-on-1 pack advantage.
Katie Klismic skates on, another grand slam for her. Praying Mantis yet to find the handle of the door out of the pack. She gets some blocking help from...
Oh, huge takedown right there.
Indeed. And Lizzie Borden looked like she thought she had a penalty, got off the track, got back onto the track. Lippy Wrongstockings returns to the penalty box. Praying Mantis skating on, looking a little forlorn. She's had some severe trouble on this jam. And Katie Klismic doing heavy lifting for Carolina in this jam, putting up multiple points and now calling it off at the behest of her bench.
Yeah, one of the bigger jams we've seen for Carolina, really taking advantage of the short pack out there that Tri-City had. Tri-City still with the lead, though, by 62 points, 103-41, just under 5 minutes left in this first half of play here on WFTDA.TV from Division II in Kalamazoo. Like to remind you that it is a pick-your-price kind of weekend. We're bringing it to you free, but asking for donations. If you could, please donate whatever you like, from 50 cents to $50 to WFTDA.tv. We appreciate every cent that comes in to help us keep bringing this great coverage all throughout the WFTDA playoffs. Of course, in 2 weeks, we're going to be heading over to Fort Wayne for the beginning of Division I playoffs. After that, down to Richmond, Virginia, then over to Asheville, North Carolina, and all the way across the country to Salem, Oregon for the last of the Division I playoffs before we see who goes to Milwaukee in November.
Just as the jam was about to begin, with careful time management, Jay Robot of Tri-City called a timeout for his team.
We will take this timeout to remind you to talk directly to thousands of Derby fans. That's what we're doing right now, and you could do it too through us. Advertise on WFTDA.tv. Affordable packages are available for your business, boot camp, or tournament advertising. Visit WFTDA.com/sponsor/opportunities to learn more.
Timeout is over. We are returning to play. 2-on-2 in the pack as we begin. Ginger Clobbers and Skate Pastor are the jammers.
And Slim, this has been a kind of a common sight in this bout. A lot of penalties for these teams. They have been spread out. Nobody's in serious trouble. We've got Fox Mulder and Praying Mantis East with 3 for Tri-City. Daisy Rage, the only one sitting on 3 for Carolina.
Skate Pastor with lead. And Ginger Clobbers has also escaped the very sparse pack, even sparser as the Hellcat of Pinar takes a penalty.
They are going to get a blocker back in number 10-13, Fox Mulder.
Skate Pastor on a scoring pass, moves through the pack, grabs what she can, and calls off the jam. That is 4 points for Tri-City.
Great awareness out there for Skate Pastor. And one thing you got to say about Tri-City, they've been very crisp. Their jammers are well aware. They're calling it off when they need to. You don't see many technical mistakes from this, albeit short, jammer rotation out of Tri-City.
After a heartbreaker of a game yesterday for Tri-City, it may have been the message in the locker room that they were to come back and do it by the book.
Absolutely. It's paying off so far. Up 107-41 over Carolina with 3:45 left. Tri-City in the white, picking up lead jam right there, Slim.
That is 40 and Whip, number 22. She faces number 42 for Carolina in the black, Ava Gore. And 40 and Whip, some speed approaching a pack. She goes inside to outside, a nice zig and zag with 4 and the door. She'll take that one.
And that's something you like to see. Sometimes you just see the zig, sometimes you just see the zag, but when you put it together, it's exceptional. It's about you. Fast Girl Skates, serving skaters of all shapes and sizes since 2007. Find them online at fastgirlskates.com, and they can customize it for you.
Two jammers who have been very effective for their teams. Katie Klismek for Carolina, and for Tri-City, number 11, Overkill. Away they go. Both of them using shoulders to move their way through a rugby-style scrum start, as is the norm in the Women's Flat Track Derby Association nowadays. Katie Klismek is your lead jammer.
Seeing good speed from Katie Klismek. She had that big jam earlier that got Carolina moving. Unfortunately, they have not been able to tack many on since then. As a matter of fact, not much at all. She gets pushed to the inside and picks up 3 right there for Carolina. So we do see some northward movement on the scoreboard, but Tri-City still in control, 111-44.
Just under 2.5 minutes remaining in the first half of play. Number 187, Caddy Compton, returns to the jammer line. She faces number 22, 40 and Whip.
And again, this is something, if you're Carolina or a Carolina fan, what you really want to see is Caddy Compton put something together in this jam. She had the 2-penalty jam, and then the last time she got re-enveloped back into the pack and then had to call it off.
40 and Whip makes an early play to the front of the pack. She is successful in gaining lead jam. Caddy Compton also escapes from the pack. She gets some support from number 66, Daisy Rage. The pack moving quickly. Tri-City attempting some pack speed control as 40 and Whip gets inside, looking for points, heads to the outside, takes a hit to the sternum, however, just puts hands to hips after scoring 3. Conservative play once again by Tri-City as they're just trying to keep that lead climbing northward.
That's right, 70 points the difference now, and they're doing a good job of just that. You know, how do you eat an elephant, Lightning Slim? One bite at a time.
Absolutely.
And that's how Tri-City is approaching this. Of course, coming into this, Carolina Roller Girls, number 4 seed, and Tri-City, the number 8 seed. So you know, looking at it, coming in, saying, okay, this is not insurmountable, but this is a challenge. This is a strong team who's been around for a long time. And they're doing the right thing by picking them apart jam by jam.
Indeed, the Carolina Roller Girls, one of the legacy teams of the Women's Flat Track Derby Association. Ava Gore picking up lead for Carolina.
It's a legacy team. Carolina, one of the original founding members, have been around for a long time. Used to be a power. They've slipped in the last few years. They saw a lot of retirement last season.
Electrocution, absolutely. Get physical with Overkill. A little too much mustard, and she heads to the penalty area as the jam comes to a close. However, Carolina picking up 4 points.
Yeah, it was great blocking. It's just you have to watch your relation to the pack. You know, she got out of play, she continued to block, and sometimes those are penalties that you don't mind taking, especially if it's effective. Was not effective there. That does mean Electrocution is sitting on 3 penalties, all 3 of them for out of play. So she's continuing to block. She's got to dial that back in.
Katie Klismic, Freudian Whip, jammers of the now. Freudian Whip tries the outside, finds it blocked by Caddy Compton, and now gets knocked to the inside of the oval. Katie Klismic out in front. She has lead. Meanwhile, inside the pack, Freudian Whip looking for the handle of the door out. Bedeviled once more by Caddy Compton. She finds her way out, but it is Katie Klismic on a scoring pass. You see her there coming from the right-hand side of your screen. Now heading the other way as she rounds the mountain. Takes a hit from Rainblows Bright, and Rainblows Bright draws the track cut. Katie Klismic wanted to call off the jam, but couldn't. She had already received that track-cutting penalty. Power jam, Tri-City.
Already 5 points. She picked up the 5th point for the jammer going to the box. This is just bad break after bad break for Carolina. It's not that they're playing bad. It's just, you know, Tri-City doing such a good job of drawing those track cut penalties.
And another grand slam for Freudian Whip, a workhorse for Tri-City. She approaches a pack at a virtual standstill. Now must negotiate this 3-wall in front of her. With patience, she breaks that 3-wall down to 2, splits the defense through for another 5.
And this is a huge chance for Tri-City going into halftime to really keep their roll going and get on an even bigger roll, build some of that momentum, and possibly kill some of Carolina's spirit into the second half.
Official time has expired, just about 30 seconds left on the jam clock. Freudian Whip puts up another grand slam inside the pack once again. Her teammates, conga line off to the side, content to let her do the work, and work she does. Another grand slam for Freudian Whip of Tri-City.
And what an asset she has been to Tri-City all weekend long already in these 3 bouts. So good that she was not injured and was able to come back.
Katie Klismic back on the track now. The defenders of Tri-City snapping into action, and the pack becomes the seething, roiling mosh pit we're used to with both jammers on the track.
Yeah, entire packs on the track as well, and that's how we'll close out the half. 4 points do go up for Katie Klismic and Carolina. It's going to push their score to 52-144. Tri-City's with a strong lead after 30. Looking at penalties, just about even. We've got 15 trips to the box for Carolina, 16 minutes for Tri-City. So that's been pretty even, but I think the difference when it comes to penalties, Slim, has been how the Tri-City girls have been able to capitalize on the power jams.
And let's not forget, AK, that injury to number 75, She's a Freak, yeah, who has put up more points than anyone on the Carolina squad. She got injured early on in this first half of play. We haven't heard from her since.
No.
It could be a devastating blow to the Carolina squad if she is not able to return in this bout.
Yeah, we'll try and see at halftime if we can get an update on her condition. Looked like a leg injury, but she was walking. So hopefully for Carolina and just in general, we'll see her in the second half. Your thoughts otherwise on the first half, Slim?
It has been a bit of a strange first half because there were some injury delays, both teams having to sort of reorient themselves after worrying about whether or not their jammers would return to play. Tri-City, with conservative play, has pulled themselves into the lead because you can build a pretty high tower out of bricks made of 3 and 4 points, AK.
That's right. It's easier to do when there's only 2 and 1 blockers out there. As we said, the penalty's about even, but they have been coming in groups. And so it seems like every time that there are penalty issues, it's a 2-on-2. We've seen a bunch of that. Looking over, the penalties are pretty spread out through the teams. Fox, Smolder, the only one with 4 penalties right now. So she's got to be a little bit more conservative in the second half. It's kind of all over the board on her penalties. We've got Praying Mantis with 3, and then on the other side, Electrocution and Daisy Rage each with 3.
My name is Lightning Slim. I am joined by AK 40 Ounce. We will be back shortly with the second half of this game number 11 between the Tri-City Roller Girls and the Carolina Roller Girls at D2 KZOO.
Thank you for joining us on WX.
Are you tired of slipping through slippery corners? Fed up with slipping on slippery surfaces? Introducing the Villain from Radar Wheels. Stride confidently through corners without slipping out. The Villain digs and holds through the corners like no other. Grips on even the worst surfaces. But don't take our word for it.
I hate sliding out. The Villains were so grippy, I felt like I was totally in control. The wheels are really grippy. They were really grippy, but they were still so fast.
Skater approved. The Villain and Villain Wide by Radar Wheels. Order now.
My name is Brenda Gold, and I've been at Rydell for 36 years almost. Everything is done by hand, basically. Just one pair actually going through at a time then. And some of them are multiple colors where it'll have 5-6 colors, metallics, the different colored full grains, you name it. Some of them are pretty wild. To me, the skaters are really important because that's what keeps us going here. It's the consumer or the skater that decides, okay, is it good enough for me or not? We want them to be happy, that's for sure.
Welcome back to the Division II playoffs of the Women's Flat Track Derby Association. My name is Lightning Slim. I am joined by my good friend, AK 40 Ounce. We're about to present to you the second half of the bout between the Carolina Roller Girls and the Tri-City Roller Girls. Tri-City up 144 to 52. And AK, what are some of the other numbers we know about what happened in the first half?
Wow, the penalties did get updated in this over halftime. Right now we're looking at 18 penalties for Carolina, 23 minutes in the notorious RED penalty box for Tri-City. But Tri-City, it's working to their advantage. Obviously, they'd like to clean it up. You always want to play a little bit tighter. The only skaters in any kind of penalty trouble right now, Fox Smulder from Tri-City with four trips to the box, and Daisy Rage from CRG. Looking at leading scorers for the Carolina Roller Girls, Katie Klismic with 25 points. She is a negative 13. Ginger and Shiza each with 9 points. Of course, Shiza going down in the first half. She was a plus two before she was out for injury. Not sure if we'll see her in the second half. Of course, we hope to. Leading scorer for Tri-City, Freudian Whip with 66 points. She's a plus 53 as a jammer. Overkill, the number two scorer with 32. She's a plus 12. Praying Mantis contributing 29 points. So she's right up there with Overkill, and she's a plus 10. I'd like to also mention Skate Pastor, who's added 17 points to that total right there. No points against Skate Pastor when she is out there jamming.
Excellent defensive play then for Skate Pastor. For the first jam of the second half, it looks like Tri-City has chosen number 11, Overkill. As you mentioned, she's been doing some heavy lifting for this squad. For Carolina, wearing the black, number 299, that is Ginger Clobbers.
And we did have a penalty at the end of the first half, so the Tri-City Thunder will be skating one short. Tri-City, of course, in the white, Carolina in the black. Carolina taking that back wall off the start. You see the high point defense right there for Tri-City with Eva Liza out in front.
Overkill forces her way to the front with the aid of that defense. She is Lee Jammer. Ginger Clobbers in the free and open space is now in hot pursuit, but it is Overkill for Tri-City. She is approaching a fast-moving pack. Heads on a swivel. The defenders of Tri-City try to make some space for her. She takes a bump there for number 1979, neutralizer, and calls off the jam.
No neutralizer, a new addition to Carolina this year. She's a transfer from a San Diego roller derby, and I'm sure they're happy to have her. She's been very effective in the pack, as we just saw.
Tri-City putting up 3 points on that jam. Freudian Whip returns to the jammer line for them. She faces Katie Klismic, number 26 in the black for Carolina.
Two leading scorers going head-to-head.
Tri-City manipulating the inside line and defending it heavily. That allows Freudian Whip to come around the outside. She's lead jammer.
That's two in a row to open up the second half for Tri-City. Tri-City led 15 jams in the first half, only six for Carolina, so that's been a big part of their success here.
Praying Mantis held up Katie Klismic as long as she could, but received an out-of-play penalty as a result. And the jam comes to a close.
2 points going up there for Tri-City. It's going to be 149-52. I'd like to take a quick second to thank some of our sponsors. Rydell, the official skate of the WFTDA. Unmatched quality, unmatched performance. Online at RydellSkates.com. Also, make sure you check out the photos from the WFTDA photo booth, sponsored by Viva Las Vegas Skates at Facebook.com/WFTDA. Learn more about Viva Las Vegas Skates at VivaLasSkates.com.
Neutralizer, who was so effective in that blocking role in the previous jam, now taking a turn on the jammer line. However, it is Overkill, lead jammer.
And Neutralizer going to the box right there. So this is going to be a power jam for Tri-City. They do have a solid lead right now, but of course would love to open it up on this power jam. Overkill right there, first grand slam of this PJ.
Overkill skating solo, approaching. A pack at a basic standstill, Overkill. Neuralizer in the box. And with a forearm penalty, we will reverse this power jam. Overkill will go into the box, Neuralizer will come out, and the power jam will be on the side of Carolina.
It's an opportunity here for Neuralizer to show what she can do jamming. We saw her a little bit yesterday at the beginning of their first bout. But some penalty trouble and lack of success got her not necessarily benched, but more in a blocking role. Big hit right there. Lizzie Borden again dishing out the pain as she is often wont to do.
Inside the pack, Daisy Ridge was in a blocking war with Fox Mulder. And oh, a hefty hit on Neuralizer. That was by Skate Pastor. They pull her back as far as they can, and a penalty coming there. That was a track cut to Neuralizer. She will take a seat. Overkill is back on the track, and we're going to trade power jams once again. All in the same jam, AK.
Yeah, a lot of scrappy play right now. Power jam again for Tri-City, and they have been very effective in power jam capitalization. Again, here we see Overkill doing it again and walking the tightrope on the outside and finishing a five-point pass.
Overkill coming out with that grand slam. Her teammates off to one side in a conga line. They're going to let her handle this four wall herself. She's pushing on that wall, trying to keep things fair. Cuts from the inside to the outside. However, the jam is over. She puts up another four.
Yep, got three there, plus the box point. And we do have an update on She's a Freak. Over to our sideline reporter, Double H, for the news.
That's right, number 75, She's a Freak from Carolina, has, she believes, torn something in her right knee. She's not sure if it's her MCL or her meniscus. She's not in a lot of pain, though, but she is going to go to the hospital to get checked out. That means she is not returning to the game, guys.
Thank you, Double H. Unfortunate to hear, but luckily nothing is broken, so we wish her a speedy recovery. Of course, Carolina will not have her, and that is definitely a disadvantage they did not need in this bout.
We now see She's a Freak. She's walking out towards her own bench, so she is able to move under her own power, but she does appear to be favoring the leg. Meanwhile, on the track, Freudian Whip, lead jammer for Tri-City, coming around the mountain. You see there on your screen the pack standing basically still. Four to beat at the front of the pack. Freudian Whip gets into it with them, keeping her hands to herself. A bit of push and shove there. They force her outside the track boundary, and she is recycled.
Neuralizer back on the track. With those two penalties, she's now sitting on 4 minutes. Joining Ketty Compton and Daisy Rage.
Freudian Whip getting a bit of support from Lizzie Borden there. A mass of black uniforms around her, however. Penalty on the play. That is going to Fox Smolder. She will take a seat in the notorious RED penalty box.
Fox Smolder racking up the penalties. She now has 5 minutes, so we've still got 24:30 left in this bout. She's going to have to be real careful, be interested to see if they dial back her playing time a little bit and kind of save her for some later action, or if they're just going to let her play through. They have a solid lead right now, so obviously you want to get her out there and keep her going and keep her warm for tomorrow, but you don't want to risk having her foul out and then, the ramifications that come with that.
24 minutes remain in the contest. Tri-City 177, Carolina 52. Your lead jammer, Overkill of Tri-City. Ginger Clobbers ensconced within the pack. She is looking for support from her blockers to try and get away from this pack. Takes a hit there from Bloody Mess. Jess falls. Penalty coming there to Eva Liza. She will sit. Overkill takes a heavy hit there from number 66, Daisy Rage. Still inside the pack. Overkill escapes at last. She puts up 4 points. and Ginger Clobbers in the free and clear, but she has only completed her initial pass. Things slowing down a little bit in the pack as Ginger Clobbers encounters the pack once more. The Hellcat of Pinar cannot hold her back. Ginger Clobbers is through. That is 4 points for her, and Overkill inside the pack herself. Knocked to one knee and then knocked over. That results in a penalty for hitting the downed skater. Number 66, Daisy Rage, will head to the penalty box.
That's going to be her fifth trip. It was 121 electrocution with that hit that sent her down, but Daisy Rage coming across with the misconduct penalty.
185 to 56, the score currently in favor of the Tri-City Roller Girls, just under 23 minutes remaining. Katie Klismic takes to the jammer line. She faces Praying Mantis. Praying Mantis for Tri-City wearing the white. Katie Klismic in the black and red for Carolina. Away they go.
And as I said, in the first half, Praying Mantis, 17 points, no points against while she was out there. So she did a good job of minimizing that. And again, she gets lead jammer here.
There she is, Praying Mantis. You see on your screen that Katie Klismic is still within the pack, held up by Mandy Maggotbone and Anne X. They're holding up her progress as long as they can. They're anticipating the arrival of Praying Mantis within the pack. There she is at the back of the pack, but she has some problems of her own with the defenders of Carolina. Evil Liza coming back from the penalty box, clears for her jammer, and Praying Mantis heads for the inside line up against a front wall. Ooh, a nice hit there by Caddy Compton, and she calls off the jam.
4-0 right there, and her scoreless against streak continues. It's going to make it 189 to 56. Scotland's first and only brick and mortar and now online roller derby store, Fifth Blocker Skates. It's Gallus. Find them in Scotland when you're in Scotland or online at 5thblockerskates.co.uk.
Och, aye. Overkill takes the jam line. She faces Ginger Clobbers. Ginger Clobbers making a play to the outside line. Quick feet for Ginger Clobbers. She has one to beat at the front. It is skate past her. She does so. Lead jammer, Ginger Clobbers of Carolina. Overkill in hot pursuit.
Ava Gore getting knocked down right there. A little slow to get back up, but she is scrambling in the pack, looking for somebody to hit. Ginger Clobbers hit herself, taken down, calls it from the floor, but picks up four. And Carolina starts moving northward again, down by 129 right now. Tri-Cities 189, Carolina 60. We've got just under 21 left to play in this game. Thank you for joining us on WFTDA.TV. AK-40-ounce here with Lightning Slim, bringing you Tri-City versus Carolina.
A tidy jam there for Carolina. They're hoping to capitalize on that and continue their upward momentum. 187 in the black. It is Caddy Compton. She faces Freudian Whip, who has been an absolute powerhouse for Tri-City in this tournament.
That's right, Katie Compton, mixed success. A little bit tougher today for her, but she does pick up lead jammer right here, and I'm sure that's what Carolina wants to see. If she can get a little bit of fire going, she can definitely chew up some of this lead.
And Freudian Whip recycled to the back. That is offense and defense working together for Carolina. That gets them a grand slam and perhaps a little more as Caddy Compton coming around the mountain towards that pack once again. Freudian Whip escapes and is skating in the free and open spaces, and Tri-City gets reinforcements from the penalty box.
Oh, Caddy Compton coming in hot right there, clearing her own path, but does it illegally. She's going to go to the box for a major back block, and that means it's a power jam now for Tri-City.
Not what Carolina was looking for. They had a little bit of momentum, but now Freudian Whip on the power jam. She's made the most of this in the past. Great recycling job by MC Fight, the captain of Carolina Dragon. Freudian Whip all the way back as Anne X from Tri-City goes to the penalty box.
Beautiful bridging job right here from Carolina, forcing her literally all the way back around, complete half-track drag back.
Killing some time as well. Freudian Whip gets into the thick of things once again. She's a little tired. A lot of backward skating for her there. And a three wall to beat at the front of the pack. She tries to outlast, does so. Now puts up five, a grand slam for Freudian Whip.
Yeah, nice face-to-face blocking from Aurora Thunder out there, holding her back a little bit.
You see Mandy Maggotbone and Rainbow is Bright standing off to one side. They know that Freudian Whip can handle this action on her own, but maybe not. A track cut sends her to the box, and Caddy Compton coming in to a brand new power jam.
That's right. Great play out there, and he saw the high five afterwards. That's teamwork. That's how he uses two blockers together. Much better than taking him one-on-one. And now Tri-City in a bit of trouble. Kenny Compton coming in, does not pick up any points before the whistle blows. We do see 4 points go up for Freudian Whip before she went to the box. But now Tri-City in a bit of a pickle right here. They only have one blocker out on the track, full box. Oh, they will have one in the queue, so they will start with two standing on the floor. Quick penalty update, 31-24. Tri-Cities has 7 more minutes in the box, not reflected necessarily in the score, but that is the deeper story of this, power jams. Carolina has not really been able to capitalize on power jams. Tri-City has shut them down when they've been in the deficit. Their shorthanded play has been very strong, and conversely, Tri-Cities has really jumped on the power jams that they've been given.
Now we see the coaching staff and captains being called into the center of the track. They're having a bit of a conference with head referee and null pointer ref.
And while they're doing that, we're going to thank Rydell, official skate of the WFTDA. Unmatched quality, unmatched performance, online at rydellskates.com.
The reason we are at a standstill right now, Tri-City using their official review. You see the flashing light there just under the score for Tri-City. That indicates they are using their official review, the one they get in this particular period of play.
Of course, both teams do get one official review per half, 3 timeouts per game. Carolina, with all their timeouts remaining, Tri-City did use one, so they will have 2 if they choose to use it.
When we find out what is happening, we will be sure to share that with the folks at home. As you said earlier, AK, 2 blockers on the track for Tri-City. That is Lizzie Borden and Eva Liza. The penalty bus is full for the ladies in white.
Yeah, excuse me. On the other side of things, Electrocution out there with Neuralizer, True Destruction, and Daisy Rage getting ready for this next one. Now, Kenny Compton had that back block penalty. She's been a little penalty heavy, especially jamming. She's got 5 minutes in the box. Daisy Rage as well with 5 minutes in the Notorious R.E.D. penalty box. On the other side of things, Fox Smolder, the penalty leader for most of the game for Tri-City, does have 5 minutes, as does Praying Mantis. Rain Blows Bright, picking up her 4th just recently. Lizzie Borden also with 4. And for Carolina, Neuralizer with 4 minutes. Adam Wheels, a proud partner and official wheel of the WFTDA, online at adamwheels.com.
You see there, the coaching staff now returning, and we will see what the result of this official review might be.
Okay, so the update from the head ref, and we will get an update from our sideline reporter on exactly what that was.
But now we are ready to begin play. Once again, Ginger Clobbers doing the jamming duty out there solo on a power jam for Carolina.
See Carolina drop back right there and let the jammer go solo. Nice move off the jammer line for CRG.
Indeed, Ginger Clobbers, lead jammer, moves towards a defensive 2. Oh, but takes a hefty hit there from Eva Liza, and a retaliatory hit from Electrocution takes down Eva Liza, and Ginger Clobbers skates on with a grand slam.
See Eva Liza spring back up into action and go right at Electrocution. Nothing major, just a little shoulder music right there. Ooh,
Lizzie Borden contacts with Ginger Clobbers but cannot remove her from the track. Ginger Clobbers skates on with another grand slam.
Carolina doing the smart thing, playing a textbook power jam derby right here, hanging back.
Ginger Clobbers squeezes her way through on the inside line. 5 more points on the board for Carolina, and Lizzie Borden heads to the penalty box.
Power jam is over. Freudian Whip out of the box, jumping into play, and Carolina right there to pick her up, knock her out, bridge back. But there's going to be a pack destruction right there as going backwards, they forgot about the other defenders up front holding back their jammer.
Electrocution heads to the box. Meanwhile, inside the pack, Freudian Whip avoids a hit from Caddy Compton and also one from Daisy Rage.
Ginger Clobbers, another scoring pass right there, already had a grand slam, and picks up another four. So we're seeing Carolina revitalized a little bit right now with 94 points, still trailing by a substantial margin to Tri-Cities 198. Not insurmountable, of course, but it is a long road with 16 and a half left to play in this bout. We're going to send it over to Double H for the update on what happened with that official timeout.
So that Tri-City review is actually disputing the fact that they believe their jammer did not actually cut another skater. The refs, of course, called it as a cut, and they maintain that because it absolutely was a cut from their perspective.
Thank you, Double H. Lightning Slim, what do we have out on the track?
Praying Mantis, lead jammer for this jam. Meanwhile, inside the pack, Katie Klismic held back by Fox Smolder and Ann X. Praying Mantis with that lead now inside the pack on a scoring pass, but she's being ably defended by number 12, MC Fight, the captain of Carolina.
Rain Blows Bright and Lizzie Borden both in the notorious RED penalty box right now, both sitting on 5 minutes. That's why Tri-Cities is short right now.
Praying Mantis could not match the speed of MC Fight as she tried to escape from the pack and was forced to call off the jam before Katie Klismic could arrive.
Tri-City does tack on another 5 points. That'll drive them up over the double century mark, 203-94. The lead with 15-15 left in the first half.
Ginger Clobbers returns to the jammer line
second
for Carolina.
Half.
Forced into extra duties, no doubt, by the injury to She's a Freak, and she faces overkill. Both jammers initially stumble, but overkill, wheel side down, comes out. She is lead jammer. Ginger Clobbers also puts on a burst of speed. You see the light reflecting from her visor there as she whips around the track. Overkill at the front, takes a hit from Beth Rowe and immediately calls off the jam. Quick work, a 4-1 jam in favor of Tri-City.
That's right, 1 point for Carolina on the skater. She lost her footing right there. It seems at times this can be a tricky floor. Been out here a lot at Wings Stadium and great venue, but this floor can get a little weird sometimes, so you got to watch out for that.
Surface management, an important part of women's flat track roller derby. There are all kinds of arenas and all kinds of wheels you can put on those skates too. Praying Mantis jamming for Tri-City. She is held back, and the jammer for Carolina, it's number 42, Ava Gore, makes a play to the front. She has one to beat Mandy Maggotbone. Mandy Maggotbone defends her as long as she can, but Ava Gore comes out. She is now lead jammer.
Nice blamming in there for Ava Gore. Cleared out some of the defenders on her own. Did a good job of getting the angle.
Ava Gore takes a hit there from Annex. Carries on, however. Grand slam, Ava Gore.
Beautiful body mechanics from Ava Gore getting forced to the outside. But she cuts hard, leans into the hit, and stays in bounds. Very, very nice work.
Praying Mantis patiently pursues Ava Gore. Ava Gore cuts from inside to outside. Takes a hit from Lippy Wrongstockings and immediately calls off the jam. Tidy work there from Carolina.
Carolina now reaching 100 points. Tri-City with a 107 lead, 207-102, as two more points were added at the end of that jam.
13 minutes remain in the contest. Together again at last, Ginger Clobbers and Overkill on that jammer line. And with them on the jammer line, all of the blockers crowding up the room in front of them, and they're going to have to squeeze their way through a wall of bodies.
Only one blocker in the notorious RED penalty box right now for Carolina.
Forearm penalty coming here, and that is to Overkill. This is now a power jam for Carolina. Ginger Clobbers has to find her way out of this pack because she is in a prime scoring position.
Big power jam break right here. We've got 12:30 left in this bout, but oh, and again, it seems to be the Carolina's curse throughout this bout. Every time they get a break on a penalty, they end up going to the box and then releasing the Tri-City jammer.
And like a fancy French restaurant, the tables have turned once again. Ginger Clobber is taking a seat in the penalty area. Overkill has been sprung into the pack. She goes. And she is out finishing her initial pass. However, Ginger Clobber's not long to sit for her. And we got two jammers again, AK.
Indeed we do. And here you see Ginger Clobber's just speeding through the pack. not really aware of where she was. Everybody just kind of doing their own thing off to the outside.
Skate Pastor will take a seat in the penalty box for Tri-City. Ginger Clobbers on a scoring pass. 5 points for Carolina. Overkill still inside the pack. She's being defended there. Electrocution getting in on that action, turning around backwards to stare at the enemy player. Overkill. Oh, struck down there in turn number four. Ginger. Neuralizer doing the damage there.
Ginger Clobbers off to the box for a major low block. So again, another power jam here. Second time into the notorious RED penalty box for Ginger Clobbers in this jam.
Certainly things heating up physically between these teams. Lots of hitting happening inside the pack. Electrocution leans on Overkill, cannot remove her from the track. Overkill taken out there just outside turn number four, returns to the track. Lizzie Borden will take a penalty.
The direction of gameplay will send her to the box. That's going to be number six for Neuralizer.
One more grand slam for Overkill as the jam comes to
Lizzie
a close.
Lizzie Borden, pardon me. Six for Lizzie Borden. Neuralizer also going to the box. That is her fifth penalty. Looking, the penalties really starting to fill out here near the end of this bout. Fox Mulder still with five. Lizzie Borden leading all penalty getters with six, but Praying Mantis with five, as well as Rain Blows Bright for Tri-City. Neuralizer and Katie Compton each with 5 minutes.
Ginger Clobbers remains in the penalty box. That means Freudian Whip flying solo on a power jam for Tri-City. She is trying to get out of this pack, but she is being furiously defended by Carolina. Katie Compton puts the hip into Freudian Whip. She tries another direction. Struck down again. Picks up lead jammer and finally escapes the pack.
Candy Compton picking up another penalty right there. Multiplayer block for number 187. That is going to be 6 minutes for her.
Freudian Whip comes around the mountain. That is a grand slam for her as she is through the pack. Ginger Clobbers has returned from the penalty box. Freudian Whip sees that, calls off the jam.
Yeah, uncharacteristic of Ginger Clobbers to go to the box twice in a single jam. She only had 1 minute earlier in this game. She had a misconduct back in the first half. Total penalties right now, Tri-City with 39 and Carolina with 30. It's been a penalty-heavy game, not the most penalty-heavy game we've seen, but we've got some people creeping up and could be knocking on heaven's door, or at least the door to the locker room.
Indeed, gritty play on both sides, AK.
Yeah, this one started out in a slugfest there, Slim. Right now we have a timeout for Carolina. Their first timeout of the bout. And we will take this time out to thank Rydell, the official skate of the WFTDA. Unmatched quality, unmatched performance, online at rydellskates.com.
I'd also like to talk about the very broadcast you're watching. WFTDA.tv is proud to bring you full whistle-to-whistle coverage of the expanded WFTDA playoff season. Show your support for the amazing athletes at the D2 playoffs with a donation to help offset our production costs. Whether you can donate 50 cents or $50, every little bit helps us continue this valuable service. Just click the Support Us button on the WFTDA.tv homepage. Donations over $20 may be partially tax-deductible.
And make sure that you can, you know, do it while you can right now. Jump on the package for Division One. It's $12 a weekend or $20 for the WFTDA Championship. But right now, you can get it for $45, the entire thing. I know I did that last weekend, and we'll talk about that more because we are back to the action, Slim.
Overkill, lead jammer, pursued by Ava Gore of Carolina. The pack being reformed under the direction of the referees. Overkill skips through to the inside line, puts up 4 points, looks to her bench for direction. Coach Business Socks gives her the nod. She calls off the jam.
2 points right at the end for Ava Gore. And I got to tell you, she has not jammed a lot, sparsely here and there, but she really is a powerhouse out there with a star. She just destroys people when she's coming through the packs line.
Absolutely. Okay, excellent relief jamming from Ava Gore. And now another hardworking jammer for Carolina, number 26 in the black, Katie Klesmick. She faces in the white for Tri-City, number 22, Freudian Whip.
Yeah, Katie Klesmick, good job, was leading scorer in the first half, did most of the scoring for Carolina, and pretty clean too. She's only had one trip to the box.
There is your lead jammer, Freudian Whip. Katie Klesmick spins around to the outside. The pack begins to race as Tri-City erects a wall in front of her. Meanwhile, Freudian Whip, you see her there, entering from the rear of the pack, gets into the thick of things, takes a bit of a jersey whip from Lippy Wrongstockings, moves her way to the front of the pack, puts up five.
Just watching right now the Tri-City Defenders, they're all touch tight, they're keeping close, and they, you know, right there it gets a little bit broken up. They did such a great job of all working in unison out there against Katie Klismick.
Lizzie Borden in a shoulder-to-shoulder, face-to-face blocking war with Katie Klismick. We see penalties on the play from both sides.
That's right. Carolina is going to lose MC Fight to the box for a out of play. And Katie Compton, it appears, is sent off as well. If that is the case, she will have fouled out.
Official review, Carolina. Coaching staff approaching the center, having a discussion with the officials.
Our score as it stands right now, 230 Tri-City Thunder, 111 Carolina Roller Girls. We have 7:37 remaining in this bout. Official review called by Carolina. I'm speculating that may have been on the penalties. We will wait and see what the official word is.
If this penalty to Katie Compton stands, she may be removed from play. And you see the referees recusing themselves to the center. They're going to have a discussion amongst themselves as to the merits of the arguments they have received from the coaches.
That's right. Now I'm going to take a quick look at the penalties in this bout. Two skaters with six officially up on the board. Katie Compton, of course, with six. Kind of all over the board with her penalties. Cutting the track, a forearm, an out of play, a back block, a high block, and a multiplayer block. So she's kind of hitting the rainbow of penalties. Lizzie Borden, on the other side of things, had those three out of plays. A forearm, another out of play, and a direction of gameplay for Tri-City. Those are your penalty leaders. Okay, we're going to send it over to Double H for the official review results.
Yeah, Carolina was basically disputing a low block on MC Fight number 12, and the call stands, so she is sitting in the penalty box for a low block.
And that was a back block for Katie Compton. See null pointer ref coming over and sending her off to the locker room. So we have our first casualty with penalties right there. Katie Compton will not finish this bout. She has been very active in the pack. Unfortunately for her, she's been penalty heavy, especially as a jammer. I'd be interested to see if Carolina adjusts. And kind of, you know, were I Dr. Feelgood, Glenn Herr on the bench for Carolina, I would probably look at Compton and say, you know what, you've been so effective in the pack. Tomorrow, we're going to keep you in the pack because she's definitely been in the negative as a jammer.
Ginger Clobbers, Overkill, jammers of the noun. Ginger Clobbers makes her way to the front of the pack. She is lead jammer. Overkill recycled, however, she also quickly escapes. Only two blockers there to help Ginger Clobbers. She has a wall of three in front of her. She knocks over one of them and calls off the jam immediately.
Nice job right there by Clobbers coming out of the official review to get some momentum going for Carolina. We're going to look to Ava Gore again to keep things going. Ava Gore, a little more jamming here in the second half, and it's been interesting to see Carolina's jamming rotation, Slim. They've used a lot of different jammers in different streaks, and really haven't been able to put anything together. They've had some runs here and there, but just haven't been able to break anything open to really close a gap on Tri-City.
However, despite not receiving many rewards, their jammers, forced into extra service, have reacted with great poise, and they continue to move forward.
Beautifully and put, Slim.
Freudian Whip being pursued there by Ava Gore. Freudian Whip has lead jammer status, but Ava Gore chasing her and forcing the call off.
Nice job by Ava Gore right there. And she, you know, like we've said, she is an active jammer. She likes to get in there. She likes to mix things up. Right now we have a timeout from Dr. Feelgood and the Carolina Roller Girls. That will be their second timeout. They will have one remaining for this last 6:17.
Our score right now, 230 Tri-City, 115 Carolina. We've got 6:15-ish remaining in this bout. Of course, coming up next, we're going to have Paper Valley versus Burning River. The winner of this bout will play the winner of that bout tomorrow at 2, and the losers of those games will be playing for 7th place at noon tomorrow. Of course, later on in the day, we still have more action coming up at 8 o'clock. The hometown host, Kalamazoo Derby Darlings, will be taking on number 2, Sac City from Sacramento, for that other chance to go to Milwaukee. Of course, Santa Cruz already, you know, they can go on to Orbitz right now and book their tickets because they will be going to Milwaukee. Whether they're going to be going as first or second, that remains to be seen, and we will find out tomorrow at 6 o'clock. And tonight at 8, we will determine who else is going to Milwaukee and who will be playing Santa Cruz for the title of this weekend.
Two ladies who know each other very well by now. Overkill in the white, number 11. Number 299 in the black for Carolina. Ginger Clobbers, jammers of the moment. They await the whistle. There it is. They bump shoulders and get right into it. Overkill makes a play through the center, but Ginger Clobbers spins around and hits the inside line. She is lead jammer.
Yeah, there's some great work out there by number 365, Erna Beat for Carolina, to defend the opposing jammer and open up that hole for Ginger Clobbers. She's very effective against Ova the rest of that pass, too.
Jam called off very quickly. Neuralizer heading to the notorious RED penalty box for Carolina.
Well, I have a feeling she's going to be doing the space balls, walking to the altar, right past and out the door, because that's number 6 and, well, number 7, and she was on 6. That's number 7 for her, so she's going to foul out. Carolina will have to put a sub in the box, and that's a second foul out for the Carolina Roller Girls in this bout.
A dwindling bench for Carolina.
Yeah, only other player in any kind of trouble is Daisy Raid. She has 5 minutes. Everybody else, relatively clean. We've got Electrocution with 4, MC Fight, and Ginger Clobbers with 3.
You see on your screen a little discussion between the two teams and their little huddles as the officials gather in the center of the track. These are but 2 teams in the Women's Flat Track Derby Association. It is comprised of 295 leagues, 198 members, and 97 apprentice leagues. That is a lot of derby girls all over the world.
Okay, so coming out of that timeout and some discussion, we will have an update, hopefully, here in just a second. Meanwhile, who do we have lined up?
Katie Klismic for Carolina faces Praying Mantis on the jammer line. Tri-City with a fairly commanding lead. Katie Klismic taken to the outside by Mandy Megabone. Mandy Megabone does the soul crush, pulls her backward as far as possible. Praying Mantis, trouble of her own at the front of the pack. However, she outlasts and is lead jammer. Praying Mantis skating on. Pack moving quickly. Katie Klismic in the free and open spaces. Aurora Thunder getting into a blocking war with Annex and Fox Smolder as the jam comes to a close. And that is a 4-point pickup for Tri-City Thunder.
So just under 5 left to play in this bout. We are just about midway through this Division II tournament here in Kalamazoo, Michigan at Wings Stadium. Great job hosting so far. Things have been running very smoothly. We're going to send it to Double H real quick for an update.
There was some confusion about Neuralizer. We thought that she did have 7 penalties. Turns out she was actually in the queue for her 6 when she was waved off to the box.
Thank you for that, Double H. So they have not lost Neuralizer. Still skating with 13 as they had lost Caddy Compton just a few jams ago.
And better news for Ava Gore at the moment. She is lead jammer inside the pack on a scoring pass. Takes a shot there from Stacy Jones. Tries to scoop through on the inside line. Does so successfully. Picks up 4 points and calls off the jam.
Absolutely fabulous footwork from Ava Gore on that inside. Got turned sideways, up on her toe stops, and moved laterally along the line, keeping in bounds. That was just great footwork right there from the Carolina jammer.
Freudian Whip returns to the Jammer line. She faces Ginger Clobbers. 3 minutes and 40 seconds remaining. Freudian Whip starts to push and take those blockers ahead of her. However, they drag her off to the side of the track. That allows Ginger Clobbers to move up to the front, but she has a wall of her own to face, including Lippy Wrongstockings. She falls. Oh! Carolina on Carolina collision. The jam called off. No change to the score.
That's right, and it was just brought to my attention that the score is 1-2, 1-2, 3-4. Carolina 121, Tri-Cities 234. The solid lead, not necessarily going to put it in the books yet, but it is nearly safe to say that Tri-City will be playing at 2 tomorrow up against the winner of Paper Valley Burning River. Carolina looking at a chance at number 7, coming in at number 4. It's a tough break, rough weekend here for Carolina.
Katie Klismick and Overkill in jammer roles. Overkill is lead jammer. You see her there coming around. She approaches a very quickly moving pack. Now she's forced to chase it. Katie Klismick escapes from the pack. The defenders of Tri-City trying to create room for Overkill. She takes a hit there. Erna Beaton doing some damage. The jam called off.
Yeah, just as Katie Klismick was coming up, another great heads-up call, and we haven't seen any of those, you know, minor mistakes that jammers tend to make. They haven't been outscored with lead jammer. Tri-City just very, very clean.
So. And with 2 minutes and 19 seconds remaining in the bout, we have a timeout being called by Tri-City.
Carolina, all out of timeouts, all out of challenges. Tri-City will have one timeout left. They did use their official review in the second half, so that's where we stand as far as time management goes. Rydell, the official skate of the WFTDA. Unmatched quality, unmatched performance. Online at rydellskates.com. I'll tell you, one of my favorite sites to go check out skates because they have the Rydell Color Lab. Lots of great color combinations. I like tinkering with that. One of my favorite color combinations, one of my announcer buddies from back home in Detroit, High Death, got red skates with silver tongues. A bit garish, but there's some meaning behind that. I'll let you figure that out.
Timeout is complete. Skaters reassemble on the track. Freudian Whip for Tri-City faces Ava Gore. Ava Gore, who's been extremely physical in a jamming capacity, likes to bash her way through opponents and has been effective as she's been called into this role.
That's right. That's kind of a look what we found here in the second half. Expect to see Ava Gore jam quite a bit more tomorrow in whichever game that Carolina plays.
No lead jammer has yet emerged. However, Freudian Whip surges to the front. Lead jammer, Ava Gore, recycled to the rear by Skate Pastor and Fox Smolder. Now, Lizzie Borden getting in on the action. A wall erected in front of Ava Gore, and Freudian Whip goes around the outside, takes a hit from Electrocution. Electrocution goes back for more and squeezes out Freudian Whip in turn number 2 there, but Freudian Whip escapes with a grand slam.
Trouble getting through the pack for Ava Gore. It seems like Tri-City has responded, figured out how to deal with her a little bit. A little bit better matchup out there up against her.
Freudian Whip biding her time at the rear of the pack, looking for a handle to get into the pack here. Tries the outside, gets past Ginger Clobbers, acting in a blocking capacity. That's another 5 points for Tri-City.
Wow, high chest hit right there, taking down Ava Gore, and that is going to shake her up enough to pass the star.
Electrocution takes that star. This is noticed by Skate Pastor, who gets the shoulder into Electrocution immediately but cannot take her off her skates. Electrocution, a big, tall skater, and she's wading into the thick of the Tri-City pack trying to escape now that she's wearing that star.
Yeah, they're just swarming all over her. Again, like you said, big target with her height. And they're just staying in front of her, trading opportunities to shoulder check her, and they do hold her back. 3 more points go up for Tri-City, though. And in the waning seconds, looks like we will have time for one last jam in this bout. Tri-City 247, Carolina 121. We've got 26-5-4 left in this bout, Slim.
Katie Klismick in the black takes to the jammer line for Carolina. In the white, number 11, it is Overkill. Both of these jammers extremely effective in their roles. We will see what happens in the dying seconds of this contest. Both jammers into the thick of things immediately. Overkill tries the inside line, but it is Katie Klismick for Carolina, lead jammer.
That's right, and you can chalk this one up as a minor victory that Carolina can take into tomorrow. Obviously, there's a lot of things they need to look at. They really need to address
penalties. But a retaliatory hit on Neuralizer by Stacey Jones. Unfortunately, it impacted squarely into the back, and Stacey Jones heads to the penalty box. Stacey Jones looking chagrined as she heads to the box.
A bit of a smile on her face there, though. Looks like she is favoring a leg. Nothing too serious, but she was slightly ginger coming off of the box.
Katie Klismick trying to find her way into the pack. Overkill held up by Beth Rowe at the front. They are shoulder to shoulder. Official time has expired. Only a minute left in the jam, should it be required. A grand slam for Katie Klismick of Carolina. And the jam is over, and so is this contest, AK.
Yeah, you see some clapping there from the Carolina bench, some high fives. They finished it strong, but Tri-City just really took control from the get-go and just powered through in this one. Here we see the Tri-City right there wrapping things up, looking very businesslike. They got to be happy. They are moving on to play for fifth place. And that's a jump for them coming in as the eighth seed. This win will move them to 4-5 on their 2013 season. Carolina Roller Girls dropped to 1-9 in their 10 bouts here in 2013. Carolina with the tunnel of love right there, letting the skaters pass through and showing some respect to the victors in Tri-City. Slim, your thoughts on the bout?
Well, I think maybe there are, for me, there are two stories in this game. First, of course, devastating for Carolina, the injury to number 75. She's a freak. She was unable to continue play. She has done more for them in a jamming capacity in this tournament than any other skater, and they sorely felt her lack. And for Tri-City, the positives on the Tri-City side would be their extreme patience, a heartbreaking loss as they took on the number one seed Santa Cruz yesterday. They recomposed themselves and attacked cool, calm, and collected this evening and took away the win.
Yeah, they were mechanical and methodical in their disassembly of Carolina in this one. Now, looking at Carolina, like you said, they lost She's a Freak. Feels that something may be torn in her knee, so we wish her a speedy recovery. But then they had to go to a little bit deeper jammer rotation. Obviously, Caddy Compton getting into a lot of trouble as a jammer, not as successful as she was yesterday, and then fouling out. So they were looking for that answer, it seems like Carolina was. They got Ava Gore some production in the second half, but without She's a Freak in there, it was a little bit easier for Tri-Cities to take that win from them, it seems like.
My name is Lightning Slim, and for AK 40 Ounce and Double H, please stay tuned. More action to come here at D2 in the KZoo.
Stay calm. See the space, and believe in your blockers. I know I trust my training. Do you? Get some athletics.